Hello, everyone, and welcome to this edition of the Stogie Geeks Show. This is episode 28, and I'm here with the entire cast and crew of the Stogie Geeks on the lines via Skype. Mr. Tim Mugherini is joining us. Welcome, Tim.
Hey, how's everybody doing?
We are doing fantastic, my friend. Thank you for sending along the Stogie of the Week. We'll get to that just as soon as we go around and introduce the rest of the fabulous cast and crew. Mr. Mark Jr. is sitting here across from me. Welcome, Mark.
Well, hello.
Mark is rooting for his Steelers team, sporting the new headsets that I've got in the Stogie Geek studio we're
there
testing out.
They are much more modern looking.
Yes, yes, they are. Yes.
Well, high tech.
Where high tech Stogie Santa is here in the studio. Welcome.
Good evening.
And, of course, Ben is with us. Welcome, Ben.
Thanks. Good to be here.
Ben, we're short one headset, but I'm going to buy another one, so we have rounded out at four.
Always short.
I rolled the dice on three of them and see if they're going to work. We'll see what the sound engineer says after the fact.
Sound great in the headphones.
They do.
Yes,
so
they do.
Whatever, crystal clear.
Whatever that says.
No well, interference.
Can't be a bad indication, right?
No.
So, Tim, why don't I lower the music here and have you dig into...
It's a blue moon over here at Paul's house or something.
I don't know.
Wow.
I just rebuilt the whole studio. Yeah. So
it
took us a half hour to get started tonight.
Yeah, bear with me. Bear with me.
Same keyboard, right?
Yep.
Okay, I'm just checking out.
Same bat channel. I like, you know me, I like to make things better, and in that process, I usually screw things up, so.
But in the end,
in the end, it all comes out
works out very well.
So, Tim, tell us about the Ramon y Ramon Familia.
Yeah, so this is a Dominican from Podicus, made in 2000 as part of the Podicus 150 Limited Edition Humidors. According to what I found on the internet, which wasn't much, what I could find was it's a Cameroon wrapper with a broadleaf binder and a Cubano and Nicaraguan filler. This is the Grand Corona at 6.25 by 47, and it is 12 years old. So a little story behind this is I was on the BLTL probably about a month back or so, and longtime Stogie Geeks listener Rex had posted up some pictures of this smoke asking what it was because he had smoked it, but he didn't know what it was. And some of the brothers had responded back that it was part of this limited edition humidor that they released in 2000. I believe there was only 1,000 humidors released with both this cigar and the Podicus 150s in it. Some people were giving them a little bit of a hard time on the forum for not reviewing it. So I kindly suggested that maybe he send some up to us and kind of, how should I say, volunteered you all to review it live on the show.
Take the burden off of him.
Someone's going to do the dirty work.
What little information I couldn't find on the internet, I do have a quote from Cigar Pass Forum, and here it is. It's, as a tribute to Ramon C. Ferrantes, the creator of Podicus Cigars, Edgar Cullman, CEO of General Cigar, commissioned the Ramon y Ramon Cigar to honor General's long relationship with Ramon. He had died at the age of 91 in January 2000. This special cigar was announced at the 2000 RTDA show and shipped to a fortunate number of customers in November. The fill of the binder, we went over that. Mm-hmm. It's an attractive.
So wait, Tim, I have a question on the filler. Piloto Cubano, is that from Cuba?
I don't know.
No, well, that means what? Cuban seed?
Piloto is where it is on
the region.
On the, yeah.
Piloto is Dominican or Nicaragua?
I would assume it's Dominican. Stogie Santa, do you have any comments?
I don't want to. I don't know. I thought it'd be Dominican myself.
It's also what's in the new Cuenca y Blancos.
Yeah, I think you're right.
Yeah, you know, now that you mention it, Mark, that's where I saw it recently.
That's a type of plant, right? That's what we're referring to.
Yeah.
Piloto.
Mm-hmm.
Or is it a region?
I'm Googling it as we speak. Oh, okay. So
sorry. I'm asking the hard questions.
I just woke up. Give me a break.
Stogie Santa was napping.
I know. Good reason.
So anyways, you guys lit yours up yet? Or?
Yeah. Yep. I'm about an inch into mine. The first thing, it was funny because when you mentioned the being a Cameroon wrap, that's the first thing I got, that Cameroon sweetness right off the first, like just about an inch. I don't know if this camera is live or not, but that's what I got off that so far. That's, I don't know. Timmy, how about you?
I get a lot of hay and grass up front, the first half inch to an inch. But after that point, the sweetness definitely kicked in, which I was happy to see.
I'm definitely getting the hay. I don't know about, like, a really strong grassy thing.
Well, it looks like Tobacconist University. Just want to make sure we have this for our listeners here. Piloto.
Piloto.
Piloto Cubano. Piloto plants are grown in the Dominican Republic and tend to be fuller-bodied and more resilient to their olor counterparts. So it's a Dominican type of plant.
Right. That's, that's the region.
Yeah.
Excellent. Paul, what do you think of yours so far?
My draw's a little tight because that's my luck with cigars.
Well, mine too.
In general. Yeah, Stogie Santa says that. We both...
Well, but it's fine.
We respectively poked our cigars.
Yes.
And mine opened up a little bit.
We poked it from behind and
it's very good. I feel like it's suffering a little bit because the draw's a little tight.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Interesting. Mine's dead on, man. The draw and burn is absolutely perfect.
Mine was kind of tight.
What about yours?
Mine was tight off the jump, but it opened up.
And mine's starting to open up a little bit, but I can still sense a little bit that, I don't know, I feel like I get like a distinct kind of, the flavor changes in the same sort of way when the draw is tight.
It is what it is.
Yeah.
But I got
it mutes it a little bit, for sure. Definitely. Yeah.
I also getting like a little, almost like a creaminess to it. A little bit with that sweetness.
Well, let's see how it goes.
It's enjoyable. It's very enjoyable so far.
It's very good.
It, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I think if it wasn't for my draw issue, it would be spot on.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I have no
complaints. I have a backup, and I'm sure you guys do, too. So.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Yeah, I put a whole little travel case out, as usual. So, in any case, that's thank you to listener Rex for sending in the Stogie
of
the
week. Thank you, Rex.
Kudos to you, man.
It's very very cool to smoke something that old, certainly, and that rare. And I was excited when Tim sent these over. So
I'm just curious.
I'm going to stick with mine and see where it goes. It is opening up a little bit as it goes on.
I'm just curious, any listeners out there that have smoked this when it was, say, 6 months or less, if they can chime in and see what it was when it was young, I suppose, that, you know, here we are. Some 12 years later.
Yeah, no, I agree. That'd be interesting. So,
here we are, a seventh grader later.
Yeah. So, I want to say that if I had to be able to identify a certain flavor and associate it with a kind of leaf or plant, I'd say Cameroon is one of the easiest flavors to pick up. And I think it's something that you can kind of like work on and achieve the goal of being able to detect that Cameroon type flavor pretty easily.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree. The other one for me is the, you know, Connecticut broadleaf Maduro, but that's almost cheating.
Right.
Like you can tell by looking at it, right?
But you got
as opposed, you know, something that just has the straight tobacco, you know, look to it, the Cameroon is very distinctive to me. Mm-hmm. Yes, absolutely.
So, with that, we will move on to talk about our Stogies for the week. What do you say, Tim?
Want me to start it off?
Yeah, please do. Please do, because I had to pull up my list really quickly here.
So, this is one you sent me, Paul. Actually, you sent me more than one, because I couldn't believe that you enjoyed this so much after I smoked the first one. It's the Davidoff Maduro Tea.
Yes.
So, I smoked two of these. Okay. I had my doubts after smoking the first, so Paul, you sent me up another. I had originally found the flavor profile a little grassy with some faint hints of leather, a fair amount of pepper. Not bad, but not great. The second one you sent me was a little better.
Okay.
A little bit more of that leather, a little bit more of that pepper, less than that of that Davidoff Avo grassiness, if you will, that hay.
Yeah, I didn't find a lot of hay in that one, but I found the flavors kind of difficult to pick out in that cigar.
Hey, that's a New England thing. I got some hay. No, anyway.
Overall, not my favorite Davidoff.
Yeah. I thought it was
good. I put try one because I think it's probably specific to what people like.
Yeah.
The construction was an A+. I'll give it up to Davidoff.
They're always like that.
I found it to be one of those cigars where you can't figure it out how much you like it. Like, it's good, but it's like, I didn't know how much to really like it or whether or not the flavor...
So it didn't move you enough is what you're saying.
Yeah, there was something like... And that's why I wanted to give it to Tim, because I wanted to get his opinion. I'm like, I'm either missing something or...
The first one was just bitter, dude. It was just bitter.
That's weird.
Wow.
Just that grassy thing, you know? The second one, I could see why some people would like it. I personally, I'd reach for a Colorado or a Claro anytime over this thing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, those are consistently the
being
best
a Maduro, I expected more of those Maduro-type flavors, and I just didn't get it. It was more of a hint in the background.
So no toastiness to it whatsoever, Tim?
No. In what I did get, you know, the leather or the pepper, it really wasn't in the foreground. It was in the background.
The back nine.
But, hey, you know, to each his own. Thank you, Paul. It was a great smoke. I enjoyed it. So
Excellent.
So, I got a question. About, since we're on the Davidoff scenario, I'd like to see Timmy and Paul give their explanations on the LE07 AVO that you both smoked.
Yes.
I want to hear this. I'm curious.
Go ahead. Go ahead, Tim. If you want to go, do you want to go first on that?
I kind of blew it for you, Tim, in the beginning. But
hey, not your fault, man.
I'm sorry. But I'm curious to see what you thought, Tim, of that cigar years later.
I think I smoked that yesterday morning. I texted
correct. You, right? This is correct. Yeah.
So I did that with coffee yesterday morning. Mm-hmm. Let me pull up my notes, actually, because it's the last on my list here.
Yeah, I did that with coffee as well. It was earlier in the day, to be in any case.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, a Claro type wrapper, which kind of tipped me off that maybe it might be something I want to try in the morning.
Right, which is a good call.
I want to say a 6x50-ish, roughly.
6x52, yeah.
Okay, I didn't measure it, but that's kind of what I guesstimated at. I got some faint cedar in the first third. Towards the beginning of the second third, some pepper kicked in. But it never really went beyond medium in strength or flavor. The last third for me is where the cigar really shined. I got a lot of cedar, some spice, a lot of nice sweetness. Performance overall was an A+. I think I had text Stogie Santa about maybe 3/4 of an inch into it, that asking him if it was a Camacho Connecticut, which of course he denied and then promptly told me what it was. But it's not your fault, man.
No, no biggie.
I think you took it as I was done, and I wasn't.
Yeah, right. And I tell you, I revisited myself, and I kind of spot on what you did before, but the grassiness hints on that is really dissipated.
Absolutely.
I mean, when I first smoked it again, that grassiness killed me.
But even in the pre-light kind of sniff test of the foot,
you could tell.
You can tell it's got that hint of grassiness, but it's not even just smelling it. You can tell you. Tell it kind of dissipated.
Oh, big time.
It got a lot in the first half inch, and then it calmed down.
Yeah. I enjoy the grassy flavors when you first light it up like that, and it kind of gives you that, I don't know, like you said, Tim, like the first inch gives you that grassy flavors, and then it dissipates.
Yeah.
I think that's the correct way to present that grassy flavor, and I enjoy it, because it's something a little different. It's not something you find in every cigar. Sure. But then to have it dissipate and transition into something else is beautiful. It's beautiful.
Right. And Tim, you were spot on. The last bit of that cigar was really good.
Yeah, that's what really kicked in and made me think we'll go good coffee.
Inch, dude. I mean, I burned my lips on it. I wish that that last third was that way all the way through, to be honest. It was really delicious.
Grassy hay flavor, and not as pungent and kind of in your face, you know?
I may have guessed it was an AVO, but I would have never guessed it was this particular cigar because I've never smoked
it. See, I kind of saw where Stogie Santa pulled it from and then handed it to me unbanded, and then I smelled it, and I'm like, oh, that's an AVO LE07. Because they already come unbanded.
Wait, which his face is in front of the counter like
yeah,
this.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It wasn't very...
I know what that is.
It wasn't very scientific.
Well, thank you, Stogie Santa.
Well, anyway, okay.
I smoked the PG, let's see... Symphony 20 Bonbons Extra. Flavors were nice. It burned good. The initial third was actually amazing. The flavors that come off the first third of this cigar are those what I called Paul Gamarian kind of signature flavors. Extremely flavorful. Fills your mouth with smoke and just lets off all this wonderful sweetness and a little bit of spice. It seemed to get a little harsh when I smoked it. I deliberately slowed down and it still kind of... It didn't live up to that first third. And then the cap fell off and it kind of fell apart and it kind of ruined the experience.
It's hard to break that up into thirds because by the time you think what's going on, boom, it's gone.
I was just going to say, like, the first third was like it was a short third, I guess is what you would call it, right?
Yeah, when I reviewed it, I did halves because, you know, it's 3 3/4 inches. Is that correct?
Yeah, correct.
Tim, I want to go back to AVO LE 2007. Now, that is, in my book, a fiver. Like, if you can still find them, I say buy five, smoke them. Here and there with coffee. That's kind of my recommendation for folks.
I would agree, 100%.
I don't think you go out buying a box of those now.
No.
Yeah, I'm questioning if I'm you know, having never smoked it before, I'm questioning if it's maybe aging out a little bit. Mm-hmm. But
There's no doubt. But the aging for me, I know what you're saying, Tim. But in the my first smoke that I had a difficult time. It was like
it's too much.
Too much. Yeah. So it's like you're catching on the way down. There's no doubt, but sometimes that can be a good thing for me on that particular cigar.
Yeah, I can see that. If that grassiness up front was,
I mean, if you like that big bold, I mean, that typical oval flip, then you would love it right in the first, first 6 months of that cigar.
So the 20 bonbons, Paul.
I said fiver, and that's really the price tag, and the fact that when I cut it, the cap kind of fell off, and I don't know what the deal was there. Could have been me cutting it. It could have been, I don't know.
The two I smoked I reviewed 2 weeks ago, performance was perfect. I said box worthy with the caveat of being the price. I mean, $8.50 right. is a lot of money for a cigar that's, 3 3/4 Absolutely. Inches long. I mean, I loved it. Don't get me wrong. I thought it was a great smoke, but on to me, right?
Yep.
Okay. This one was gifted to me. Dominican Cohiba Maduro.
Yes, the red dot.
The red dot. So I've smoked a lot of red dots in the past. Mm. I've never had the Maduro, though.
I have.
So this was gifted to me by a gentleman that I often talk to on the train. Mm-hmm. Went down to Florida, visited Corona Cigar, and brought me back this in a David Off Millennium. Mm-hmm. How can I complain about that, right?
No, hey, hell of a nice guy. I want to go on that train that you go on. I mean, I want to meet these people. Nice people.
It's
great, man. I know, huh? Giving out cigars.
This thing had a wrap on it that was just rustic. I mean, it was almost black. It was wrinkly, veiny.
Ugly.
Just ugly, fugly, so much so it was beautiful.
Oh, it was.
If you could get my drift. Oh, yeah. So ugly, it was beautiful. It had a nice pre-live aroma of leather and pepper. The flavor profile followed suit with leather, espresso, and pepper. But the body strength flavor never passed a medium for me. It performed well. It was a little mundane. I said the angler.
I'm glad you said that, Tim.
Ding, ding, ding. Mundane.
Yeah, mundane. Yeah. Oh, you see my eyes pop. Yeah. I got to that last third. I felt like I fell asleep tonight coming over here. I fell asleep smoking that cigar.
Yeah, exactly. By the last third, I was ready for it to be done.
It was unbelievable. I mean, it's like... You've got to be bad. Kidding.
Aren't they expensive, too?
Oh, yeah. They're the $15 to $18 range.
That's an awful lot for an angler.
I mean, it is what it is. But you know something? Our angler could be someone else's, oasis. And it doesn't make, just because what we think doesn't mean anything what we think. But
you know what, man?
Haven't we talked about that?
Yeah, exactly.
It's not something I would drop $18 on, so I really appreciated the gift.
Oh, absolutely.
It gave me the opportunity to try something I wouldn't know.
That's right. That's worth it in a sense right there.
So. Those are the best gifts, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. I've always said that. It's something you wouldn't normally buy for yourself.
Right.
Okay. I'm revisiting here. Okay, Tim, I don't mean to cut into your assessment on this. Ramon, I'm probably 2.5 inches into it. Have you got just a little, I just picked up almost like a cedar.
Yes.
Yeah? Yeah.
That's pretty accurate.
I'm at the halfway point. I'm finding the second, third much more enjoyable than the first.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's definitely picking up. That's for sure. The flavors are, at least. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Did the draws open up for you guys?
Yeah, draws open. How is the ash dropping on that Stogie Santa? Does it leave much of a stain on your pants?
A little fertilizer for the crotch, make it grow.
Do you want a little water to take it out?
Mrs. Santa's at home. Drop it again! I need a lot of fertilizer when you're over 50, Okay. Anyway.
Wow. That was way more information than I wanted.
I know. Sure. Okay.
I don't want to talk about your ash anymore.
No, my ash.
So the flavors definitely intensified. The flavors in the first third, to me, kind of had that almost astringent, kind of like citrusy kind of flavor. And then they're starting to warm. It feels like it warmed up a little bit, and now the flavors are a lot more toasty. And cedar, I think, is a very accurate description of that.
I would agree with that, yeah.
I'm enjoying it more than I was the first third.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, definitely.
Me too.
Most definitely.
And again, okay.
Speaking of cigars I enjoy, Viaje 5th Anniversary.
This is
the 6.25 by 52 box press Perfecto. It's a Nicaraguan Puro. What a wonderful, smooth and flavorful smoke. Nice change up. Burn, draw, construction was awesome. The finish was just kind of okay. I mean, I'd have to smoke more to really kind of get a better description of what I experienced in the finish. I know that the first third was, wow. I mean, just came alive with flavor. And something you don't always expect on a hit or miss Viaje limited special edition. I mean, sometimes they can go horribly wrong, and sometimes they can be winners. This one, to me,
I was surprised when you chatted me this, man, because I smelled the wrapper on mine and I thought it smelled sour, to be honest. So I was going to put it down for a few weeks.
Really?
Yeah.
I thought mine smelled awesome.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Oh, I liked the only thing, like I said, the last third, I had a sticker right in the middle of it, and I was having a little difficult time, which it can happen, but for the most part, I had definitely a fiver.
Well, the kicker is, too, if you sniff the wrapper and you get this, like, wonderful aroma or some kind of aroma that smells of despair, then you probably know it's time to put it down in your humidor for a while. Yeah,
it can happen. I mean, everything's probably did the right thing.
Maybe I'll put it on my list for the next show. We'll see. We'll see what it smells like in a couple weeks.
I don't think I've seen that in a review yet. Despair. That's a flavor.
From Better Off Ted?
Yeah.
Hey, what? It's something like new all the time.
Exactly despair. What you're talking about.
Despair. Hey, Tim, I like that. What was the other one after Angler?
We're going to talk about that.
Okay, good.
Tim, I think it's your turn now. I'm sorry. It is not your turn yet. My rating, the fiver. For the fifth anniversary. I'm saying fiver. I don't know if I'd go out and buy a whole box of them.
No, I mean,
sometimes
say
it's just, it's like a gut, gut kind of thing, but I'm saying fiver.
Yeah, me too. I agree.
What's on those Stogie Santa? $11 and change?
Yeah, $11.50, yeah.
Okay. It's an expensive stick, no doubt.
It is. I mean, again, what isn't when it comes out with a special releases? Yeah.
Well, speaking of one in that price range, this is the one that the LFD rep gifted me last week when I was in the shop.
Mm-hmm.
This is Lito Gomez Diaz Vintage 2012 Paisano.
Yep.
It's a 5.5x52, kind of super robusto, if you will. Honestly, it might be my cigar of the week. I think the flavor profile of this blend really fits me. I like nuts, and what I get off of this cigar is a lot of cashews, buttery cashews is the way I describe it. There's definitely some spice. But it's that cashewy, nutty flavor profile that I just love. Absolutely delicious in my book. Strength, flavor, solid medium until the last third where it picked up significantly. Not unusual for an LFD cigar.
Mm-hmm.
I say box worthy.
Mm-hmm.
Another one I recently had was one that Mark Jr. gifted some of us, and that was the Americano.
Yeah.
That I believe is based on the same blend. This is just a newer version.
It is. It's the Diaz. Yeah.
I found the
smokes.
I get the nut flavor. It's almost like an explosion.
Yeah. Paul, go ahead. Continue.
Sorry.
Oh, why are we going down this road?
Nut explosion in your mouth.
Wow. Okay.
Sometimes it makes its way into your nose.
Let me guess. This is an oasis.
Oh, it's the cashews.
Oh, man.
It punches you in the back of the throat.
I turn it around here, guys. Come on.
Wow. Oh, God.
Son.
Please help me.
I say box worthy.
Oh, absolutely.
It is a cashew flavor. I think Tim's got the flavor profile up.
Oh, all right.
Yeah. Nailed it, actually. Yeah.
Chocolate or nuts.
La Duane.
More of these seems like a budget. I think I've blown my budget in the last 6 weeks.
I've raped my budget lately. Yeah.
Man, what's all these condensations coming out with nuts, rape, and everything else? Let's stick to cigars.
But the most horrifying thing is this talk of this whole budget thing.
Well, we got a budget? Spend.
Mine went right through that thing a long time ago.
Tell me about it.
Yes, we do, but we won't go there.
La Dueña Short Robusto. This size, we've talked a lot about this cigar. This size, box worthy. I mean, I can't say enough about this blend. The flavor profile is different between the Short Bellicoso and the Short Robusto. Now, this was the Short Robusto that I smoked, but I also smoked the Short Bellicoso, which I'll talk about probably too. I guess I'll talk about both of them here, because that's what I wrote. The Bellicoso shape, I find, intensifies the flavors, and I get a lot more pepper.
Oh, yeah.
The Robusto, it delivers them differently. It's a different flavor delivery, and there's a big difference. Not as much pepper. It's that same La Dueña enjoyable thing, a lot more pepper up front. It kind of dissipates, and again, I think it's because it's like the same ring gauge throughout the whole cigar and doesn't taper off, that you get that kind of different smoking experience. Now, the shorter Robustos and short Bellicosos are just fantastic. It's a little more of that flavor crammed into a tighter package than the larger sizes, but still extremely enjoyable. I really want to buy a box of the short Bellicosos and a box of the short Robustos. Maybe, like, I wish they'd come in boxes that would mix.
Split.
Mm. Yeah, like a 10 and 10 of each. So if anyone wants to split, of course, everyone said they already blew their budget. So
doesn't mean I'm not going to buy more stuff.
That's true.
Just saying I destroyed it.
Yeah, I smoked a short belly last night, and I really, really like that size of this blend. It's just awesome. Just my opinion. But.
Excellent. Tim, over to you.
So this is one I've always wanted to try and never get around to. It's the Arturo Fuente Don Carlos. Stogie Santa gifted this to me. I want to say he said it had 4 to 5 years of age.
Correct.
On it. I did not take Stogie Santa's recommendation on this. He told me to have it with coffee first thing in the day, and, well, I didn't listen, which is my fail. I smoked it after we smoked the La Dueña on the last episode of the show.
Oh, you must have lost everything on it.
Yeah, and that's exactly what happened, Stogie Santa. Mm-hmm. I lost a lot of flavors on it. Mm-hmm. It was enjoyable, but I really couldn't pick up a whole lot of the mild flavors on it.
Right. That having that Cameroon wrap, that's what happens. You know, and it's a perfect morning cigar with coffee.
So my apologies. I say try one. Not bad. Certainly, I will revisit. Perfect construction. It is what it is. Next time I listen.
That's it. No biggie.
I smoked the original Quesada Oktoberfest Bavarian Robusto. And this is the original.
That was last year's release.
Yeah, last year's. There was some kicking around in the local shop. So I went back to my humidor and I pulled one from the original. Or I bought one. I bought one and I said, I'm going to smoke it. And I did with some beer. And, I drank the beer and I smoked the cigar, just to clarify. I didn't smoke the beer. But they go well together. I think it has a great beer profile. I think it tastes a lot like sweet barley malt. Gives it that real kind of beer flavor. I wish these would burn better. You know, this one started off good, but it just didn't produce enough smoke for me. And I read a couple of reviews on it, and a lot of people report the same thing. Like, it doesn't produce a lot of smoke at different points.
And that was blended in mind with the Paulana Oktoberfest beer.
Yes.
Yeah, the Marzen style beer.
Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So the construction seems to be hit or miss. However, you know, when they burn right, you pair it with a beer, and they go really, really well together. I paired mine with an Omegang Adoration. It's a special winter ale, 10% alcohol. And if you pair it with one of those, no matter how your cigar does, you're happy at the end. So. Mm-hmm.
Now, it's interesting because I smoked one of these this week, too, and I have never smoked one, so I was pretty excited to finally try it after a year. Mine performed. It's the best performance I've had out of a cigar in probably a month, to be quite honest with you. Poured smoke. I had an inch and a half in long ash. I was actually able to stand it up on its ash.
Yeah, it was great. I saw that was a great picture.
I sent you guys a picture.
Picture. Quesada Cigars, I believe, commented on the picture.
Yes, they
on
did.
On Facebook.
I mean, I'm telling, enormous amount of smokes on each draw. It had the best draw I've had out of a cigar in the longest time. So to hear you say that, Paul, I'm amazed.
I agree with that assessment, too. I've never had issues with smoke.
So I bought a fiver of them, too, and I have to side with Tim on that one, to be honest.
Yeah. Okay, you're at it.
I would say I really enjoyed this cigar the most because it was very, very unique, right? Yeah. And we all smoked so many cigars that it's kind of hard to get like a flavor that doesn't exist in really any other cigar, right? Mm. And that one really kind of does that, and I like it a lot because of that.
So I said box worthy.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I agree with that assessment.
Because it's such a unique flavor profile, and again, the performance was just an A+ on the single one I smoked. And I'll put that out there as a caveat. I smoked one.
Now the it says the wrapper is a Dominican Cibao.
I'm not going to help you out on Spanish. That one.
Cibao Valley Habano, and the binder and filler are both Dominican Republic, blended by Manuel Quesada.
Mm-hmm.
His great nephew, job, Manuel.
Yeah, his nephew was in a store this week.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, he. I passed on the word. I think he was really upset. Remember you mentioned about the Jalapa series being broken in some of the delivery?
Yeah.
He was livid. He said, I didn't hear anything about that. How'd you know that? I said, friend of mine just happened to tell me. Where did he get it? I mentioned where he got it from. He even called up that particular place, and he was really upset about that particular notion, not even knowing anything about it. So,
well, hey, man, it is what they it fix is. Something about it then, because it's a shame. Those are, I don't know if that's on anyone else's list here. I just got that. That's pretty special.
Yeah, so tell us about it.
Oh, that's Mark. Really good.
I just got a box in on Friday, actually. From an internet retailer. And
what size?
The Robusto.
Actually, and, that's what I ordered.
Yeah, and they're freaking ridiculously good. Mm-hmm. If for those of you out there that like the Quesada España from last year, which I did, mm-hmm. I love it so much that I ended up buying a box of those too. It's similar, but it has a lot more sweetness to it at the same time, and it's just remarkable, mm-hmm. really, how good it is. It was the two that I was most excited about going into the IPCPR, right? Were this and the Oliva Melano, right? Mm-hmm. And it lived up to every expectation mm-hmm. that I had for it and surpassed it to some point. It's box worthy. I mean, it's hard to say Oasis on a cigar that just came out, right?
No, right. But, exactly. That's
it's certainly box worthy. And in fact, I want to buy another box.
Mm-hmm.
So it might be two box worthy.
Mm.
So
nice.
Plus, they're really inexpensive, actually, which is really awesome. You know, I think I got a box off the internet for like $65.
Wow.
You know, plus shipping. So, like, you know, which is really reasonable, man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so. But the box being 10.
A box of 10, right. Yeah.
I mean,
so that's why I'm saying a box, two boxes really is only one box. Right. So.
And you know something we pulled out of the vault, Mark Jr. and I really love these deals, the IA shorts.
Oh.
Oh.
Oh, yeah, those are good.
Yeah.
Oh, they're unbelievable.
Are those the exclusivos?
Yeah.
Those little tiny ones.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my goodness gracious.
The more of those. I mean, we're getting off track here.
Right.
So we should get back.
Yeah, let's get back.
But I will say that exclusivo blend, I've now tried four different sizes in it, and every single one of them is kick-ass.
That's something you can stick with. But anyway.
Age on those, too, man. They're just they're something special.
I smoke the Casa Fuente Corona Gorda. This is a great Cameroon wrapper on these smokes, right up there with some of the great Fuente and La Aurora Cameroons. I think if I had to pick a company that makes the best Cameroon, it'd be a toss-up between Fuente and La Aurora.
I would agree.
1A, 1B.
Yeah, I would
definitely agree.
Full flavor, spice, and everything nice. It doesn't change up all that much, but delivers in the flavor department. I'm not sure why these can't be available at more than just the Casa Fuente store. I mean, having them just be there, that really doesn't help anyone. It doesn't help the store make any more money. It holds them back. It doesn't help them pay their rent, which drives up the prices for the customers who go in there and buy stuff at an already exorbitant rate anyway. I mean, also, when you go to Casa Fuente, it's all about smoking all these Casa Fuente blends. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think people are kind of forced into buying the house blend when they're there rather than maybe spending their money on some of the...
Sounds familiar.
Like, when I go there, like, I feel compelled to buy the Fuente house blend.
Hopefully he's not listening.
But I'm compelled to buy that, even though there's this other great stuff. Like, I buy, like, a sampler of the Casa Fuente stuff. That's because that's the only place I can buy it, right? If I could buy it somewhere else, when I visited Casa Fuente, I'd take that money and I'd put it towards maybe some other rare, different sizes and other stuff. So I'm not saying I wouldn't spend the money there, because I know how much I'm going to spend going in there, which is a lot.
On the way out,
I mean, it's a lot, right? But I'm kind of forced to put some of that towards the... And also, the Casa Fuente blend is probably overpriced by at least 20 to 25%. So
that's on a very
conservative. That's conservative, right? But didn't they make a Rosado wrapped one that was supposed to go to select retailers, and then it never did.
Made it.
It never went out. They did. The whole thing should just be on the internet. To retailers.
I don't get it.
Let people buy them. Right. I don't understand.
It's just like you said before, business 101.
Yes, Paul,
why just keep it to one spot?
I don't know. I'm just saying.
Still.
What's that, Tim?
I can't smoke
you
a waitress.
You wouldn't have the waitresses there.
Well, you'd still go there for the waitresses, right? I mean, you don't. I mean, really? So you've got all these rare Fuente sticks. You've got the waitresses and the best mojitos in the world. Do you really need to keep the Casa Fuente blend?
Right.
Just
it's
Casa
not like
Fuente?
People like us aren't going to go there anyways if yeah, that stuff is not exclusive,
yeah,
right?
Exactly. So. Also, it's an Opus X binder and filler, but it tastes nothing like an Opus X binder and filler. It says a tweaked Opus X blend. I don't know what that means. Like, is that like what falls off after they make the Opus X and then there's stuff in the, I don't know.
Short fill or something. Who knows?
Something. I don't know. I'm not saying it's bad. I'm just saying it doesn't taste anything like the Opus X binder and filler, in my opinion. And I'll smoke a couple more.
Plus, the wrapper's completely different. Risotto versus Cameroon, right?
Yeah, this wrapper's Cameroon. And again, it's that tweaked Opus X blend. The Corona Gorda is 5 5/8 by 46. Construction and burn and draw inside the size. I mean, this was my favorite size in this blend, hands down. Even the risotto wrapped ones, this one happens to be my favorite. The thing is, the MSRP in this bad boy is $18.
Wow.
For a Corona. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Now, I bought a sample pack, so I saved, you say when you buy a sampler pack, you save a few dollars. So. A
couple of bucks.
So what was mine, 16? You know, it's still, it's 16.
Whatever.
Yeah.
It is what it is.
It is good. It's not life-changing or anything like that. So, Tim, back to you.
Cool. Just want to say, hey, Rex, he's listening live and he's in the chat, so.
What's up, Rex?
Well, hey, Rex.
Thank you for the smoke of the week, my friend.
Howdy. Great smoke, man. Thank you very much.
Mm. Yeah, I'm really enjoying it. Should we get back to it?
Yeah, let's go back to it. Yeah.
I'm in the last third, actually.
Yeah, me too.
I'm just heading into the last third.
Yep.
Yeah. I had a lot of the hay come back right now, so I'm kind of missing the second, third, to be honest with you.
Me
we'll
too.
We'll see where it goes, though. I'm just starting it.
I agree with that. And a little on the aging out process.
Ball knock.
If that flavor's hay, maybe I'm not there yet, but.
Just a little bit.
I like it.
That Cameroon sweetness and the cedar is just really a nice combo.
Yeah, I think you're spot on with the flavors. I wouldn't disagree with that at all.
It is, like I said, it is a very good cigar,
isn't it?
And it's held up really well for a 12-year-old cigar.
Absolutely. Yeah. He must. He knows what he's doing, keeping these humidified like this. But like I said, just that little poker that I had to use there, and that was it. I'm not. You know, that doesn't even bother me.
I did one poke.
Yeah, that's it.
And it didn't seem to change the. It helped it actually. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah. Sometimes when you poke the cigar, it just
opens up and billows out. It's horrible. Loose, whatever.
Yeah. Well, I'm sorry, Tim. Back to you.
All right. So I did the Viaje Honey and Hand Grenades.
HHG.
You guys smoke these yet? Or?
Yes. I have.
Okay. I did both the Shiv, which is a 5 1/4 by 52, and the Shank, which is a 6 1/4 by 50.
Are these named after prison weapons? Is that the...
Yes, I believe so.
Except for the rapier.
Mm-hmm. The rapier? Is that
why
what
you're saying?
Why wouldn't it? I don't know, man. That could be...
Or maybe it is.
Whatever.
Is there a bunch of quarters in a sock? Size.
Wow.
No? Alrighty.
That's when you grab your ankles and you...
The roofie?
Wow. Man, oh man. Okay, go ahead, Tim.
Nicaraguan Puros, I believe. All Perfectos, I think. Very odd shaped and sized. I get a combination, very interesting combination of cayenne pepper and sweetness off of these. Not a lot of complexity. I did enjoy the smaller ring gauge, the Shank, more than I did the Shiv. I think I got a little bit more sweetness off of it.
Matter of fact, I have both.
All in all, I think this blend is going to be a hit for some and a miss for others. I think it's going to be very specific to what people like in flavor profile. So I said try one. Mm. What do you guys say?
I agree with some of that. I think, the pepperness was decent, but I think it needs some time because on the last maybe third or less, I end up getting a real, almost like a bitter taste to it. And I think, like I say, another 6 months from now, typical, not just Viaje, it can be any cigar, but I think it's going to be a good fiver.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I think it's a fiver, but it's a fiver that I'm going to buy and not touch for a while.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, I smoked one so far, and I would agree with your assessment of the end. It kind of turned a little bit.
Yeah.
So I'm going to definitely put these aside for a little while.
And for once, I didn't get one that was wet. And that's one of the biggest things I've seen.
TNTs. Oh.
I don't think they were wet.
No. For the first time that they haven't been. You know what I mean? Like the shotgun shells, they were, I don't know how yours, when they came in the store, I had to put them down for a little bit. They were wet.
You definitely should be smoking those again now, though. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I smoked one of them recently, and wow, it's awesome.
Oh, that's it is. They're coming back out with those, too.
Oh, good thing.
Yep.
I smoked EP Carrillo Edition Inaugural 2009 again.
Again.
Because you know why? Weird. I want to stress the point that you should be smoking these.
Yeah, right.
So I took it upon myself to smoke another one just so I could come on the show and stress the point that you should smoke this in the morning with coffee. They're still great. They're full of flavor. Bearing. It's nice smoke. They seem to be tapering off.
Yeah, they're starting to peak, correct?
Yeah. Let your other smokes age while you're smoking these. So Boxworthy, smoke them if you got them.
That's it.
Okay.
I'll tell you, this is a nice little combo. Where's that bottle of rum?
The Diplomatico.
Yeah, Diplomatico in this.
It is.
Oh, goodness gracious.
The smoke is warming up again on the last third. I'm really enjoying it. I'm getting that cedar again.
Yeah, man. These are surprisingly good. Yeah.
It's got a great finish, and it does go well with that Diplomatico.
I'll tell a quick story about this cigar, actually.
So yeah, please Paul do, because I'm getting more ice and stuff in my glass.
Paul handed me this smoke, and... instantly, so I have this weird memory where, like, when I see stuff, it instantly comes back to me, right? And as soon as I saw this band, these are in the humidor of a store close to us in the back, in the humidor that they're supposed to come in, and I've looked at them, like, 5 times, and looked at them and been like, oh, that's weird looking. They look awful cheap. I don't want them, right? But now that I'm, so that this should speak to that, like, maybe you shouldn't have, like, preconceived notions and you should just try stuff because I've been looking at them for a year and thinking, oh, I don't know about that, right? And then now I'm smoking it and I'm really, really, I really like it. So
we should go there together and maybe buy some.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, let me say this. If you go there together to get some of these, make sure you grab some of the Podicus 150s from that humidor if they have them.
Are they awesome?
Oh, they're really good.
I was always part of that humidor, the limited edition humidor, and the reviews I've read.
That's one of my white whales.
Incredible.
Is it really?
Partagas, yeah. Or is it in the? Is there a Punch 150 or a Partagas 150?
It's a Partagas 150. They were rolled in 1995, released in 2000.
Right.
Yeah. I've always wanted to try one of those.
So if they have those limited edition humidor there, make sure you get some of those,
too. I'll call the guy that I know that works there.
Yes, and, I know who you're talking about.
And we'll go down there together.
We can hold hands. It'll be awesome.
Oh, it'll be great.
We're looking at, me and Ben are left out here, like, what are we going to do? Like, you know what I mean?
We'll bring them back for everybody.
Huh? I'm all kidding. We'll go on a mission. Some of that. Oh, absolutely. know what I had at the show was that box press Casa Magna. That was an awesome smoke.
Was it really?
New one?
Yes. Okay. Very good.
Is it like the Domus Magnus?
It's totally different.
The Colorado blend, just box press.
Right, exactly. A very, very good smoke. I meant to tell you that, guys, because like I kept talking about the Jalapa, the Headley Grange, Cueco Blanco. But that one, I meant to bring that up a while back. That's something that it's really, really, it's a great little, I think it's like, it's hard to go by when you got a box press what size it is.
Yeah.
Probably like a 6x50. But are nice, nice. They did a great job with that.
And that's made by Caseta too, right?
Yeah. Oh, they are something. They're just hitting home runs every time.
Yep.
They're bringing it.
That's interesting because I didn't really like their smokes before last year all that well, right? Yeah. Like, they were never offensive to me, but were never my favorites. And then
the Tribute was kind of like...
Exactly. You would just pick up the white and yellow labels. This is going to ask Tim, because I did that on the closeout. And they were okay.
Yeah, they're not horrible.
No. Yeah. But, I mean, when you're getting from, like, $3 a stick, I mean, they're actually, you know...
Well, that's what I'm saying. Yeah, they're not
great.
Well,
I had a big 6x60 size in that, too. That was the one I tried.
I know the Colorado won the, like, Cigar of the Year.
Yeah.
It was good, right? But then they came out with the Domus Magnus. Then it was the España. Then it was the Oktoberfest. I really kind of liked the coup d'etat, the Molotov, right?
Molotov was awesome.
And I think that they're just killing it right now. They're killing it, dude. Yeah,
it's killing me because my Jalapas came in earlier than I thought, so they're sitting on my desk at work right now, and I'm not going to be back in the office until Tuesday. So
sorry to hear about that.
Drive me nuts, but
wow,
mine are in my humidor right now.
So I smoked a Viaje Skull and Bones Moab from March 2011. This was like my last one, and I wanted to bring it up because I'm really upset, and I needed moral support because this is such a great smoke. It's kind of like the shotgun shells. Yes. Almost a similar flavor profile, but similar, I think, more in that it's the perfect nighttime smoke. When you want to go out, you don't want to be out for like 3 hours or anything. You know, you want to go out, you want to have a 45-minute smoke. It's the your last smoke of the day. You want to just relax with something that just pours flavor. The Bellicoso-sized Skull and Bones Moab was it for me. They're still box-worthy. I was looking to replace these with something. What do you replace that with? La Dueña Short Bellicoso is pretty much on the list. I don't know if you guys have any other suggestions to a really good... I want to put you on the spot a couple of times tonight, but I want a really good 45-minute, nice smoke, full-bodied, last cigar of the day.
Okay, does it have to be currently available?
Yeah, it can be whatever you... Well, for me...
Same flavor profile, Paul? Or
the mystery box press.
The mystery box press fits that, yeah.
Yes, dude, yeah. Those were awesome. Yeah.
Can you age cigars?
Yeah.
I just like the VSG Robusta.
The Skull Crusher, give it another 6 months to a year. Remember the Skull Crusher Surrogate?
Yeah, I haven't talked about that yet. That one blew me away.
Paul's list, yeah.
Wow. Any other suggestions?
It's tough to come by, dude.
Okay. It is.
What about the Espana Short Robustas that you like so much?
Yeah, those are good. I find I enjoy those like with coffee in the middle of the day.
They're not terribly strong, though.
No. Yeah,
they're not that's another thing, too. No. Yeah.
If you could find a nice, strong, short Robusta, maybe a Petit Edmundo might
you could do that.
Yeah.
Or a Tray Mystique.
Yeah. Yeah. I've got some VSG. Maybe I'll give that a shot.
Tray Mystiques are really, really good. Yep.
Absolutely. Tim, back to you.
So last one on my list, actually, I reviewed the Old Man in the Sea by Pete Johnson. This is the 2012 release. This is based on the Black Label blend, and I smoked the entire coffin, the 3 Calibra and the Lancero. I reviewed the Calibra. I haven't smoked all of the Black blend, but I've smoked enough.
Now wait, Tim. You did take those apart and smoke them separately, right? You didn't smoke all three.
Well,
okay, just checking. You said you'll smoke all three. I wasn't sure.
I did one Saturday morning. I did one Sunday morning. And okay. I did one Monday morning with coffee.
Because I was kind of compelled to smoke all three at once, but Stogie Santa had to set me straight. I'm like, hey, you just cut all three and
like Peroni disease.
Have you smoked the block yet?
Like, what happens when it gets to the string? Does it just burn through the string that holds them together?
Oh man!
Now the string just falls off.
Yeah.
Hope you're kidding, right?
No, I'm only joking.
Okay.
It is weird to smoke the Calibra. Am I saying that right? Calibra, right?
Yeah.
Calibra. Yeah.
Calibra.
What's weird is they burn perfectly, man.
Yeah, they do.
I was holding a 2-inch ash.
Last year's did too, man. It was astounding to me and how well they burn.
Oh yeah, a lot.
Ben
of
and I did that the Calibra from last year's old.
Yeah, it was very good.
Now last year was the Triumphador, correct?
Yeah, yes.
It was the El Triunfador with the Sumatra wrapper.
No.
Along with one with the Connecticut wrapper.
You had two of the, last year's Old Man of the Sea was two Lanceros of the Broadleaf, not the Sumatras.
That's not what Edgar said.
What I read online was the Calibra last year was the El Triunfador with one Broadleaf Lancero of the Black Blend.
Yeah.
Is that correct? Or?
Well, I thought I could have. There was 5 cigars. Let me see. One. All right. It could be. I have to look. I know it wasn't
there
the
was
Sumatra.
One of the Broadleaf and then one of the new ones that have the red labels. The Calibra was the one with the red labels on it, according to Edgar, who's the rep. But
I didn't see any. No, on they were bandless.
I know they were.
Yeah.
It's
on that one. Yeah. But not on the Lancero.
No, the Lancero is the Broadleaf.
Right,
the Calibra
correct.
Was the Sumatra.
Sumatra. Right.
Yes. Okay.
Yes, correct.
That's what I was saying. Okay,
yeah. I'm
okay.
Sorry. Excuse me.
No problem. No.
Back to the 2012 release.
Yeah,
I loved these smokes. It's the best of the Black Blend I've had to date. I haven't smoked all of them. I've never smoked the Corona from the Jar release, but I have had the Black Tubos. I've had the Petite Lancero. I had the Lancero from this coffin.
The Robusto. The Robusto, I thought, was the weakest of the blend.
This Calibra, awesome. Never Lots of cinnamon spice. Paired perfectly with my dark roast. Perfect burn, perfect draw. I enjoyed every single one of them. I say box worthy, or in this case worthy, because I think it's 10 coffins to a case.
Correct.
My full review, I link to it in the show notes. But the interesting thing about this is the Lancero that was in the coffin, I found flat.
Mm-hmm.
It actually a very different smoke than the other three, which just amazed me. But maybe that's just me. Maybe my palate at that point was, you know, worn out. It was the end of the weekend. I certainly recommend picking up a few coffins of these if you can find them, though.
That's the reviews I've read on that so far, actually, is that the Calibra smokes are better than the Lancero's. The straight
really?
Lancero smoke, yeah.
Okay.
You're not the only one I mentioned that, Tim.
Yeah, if you look on Cigar Pass, Tim, you'll see.
Before I smoked, you know, maybe my palate was raped a little bit.
Oh, look at this.
Maybe not.
No. I'm looking on screen here.
Oh, that's awesome.
The Boulevard.
Royal Corona.
Yeah.
Cuban. So this we've got a new screen in the studio. If you're watching the live stream, it's behind Mark Jr.
What is she doing?
Yeah. Oh, wrong window. So I don't know how well you can see it in the video, but I think it might help all of us in the studio. It certainly gives me a better screen to look at, so I'm not looking down at my screen. But I've got it there, a Boulevard Corona. And we're just talking about a stick to kind of have that last cigar of the day. Yeah. Boulevard Corona, I think, fits that profile.
Right, but it's not as strong.
It's not super strong.
But I love that cigar.
Oh, it is just...
I love everything by that company. Yeah.
Oh, they're just magical. I said outstanding smoke, medium body, wonderful, full of flavors. It burns great. Just an overall enjoyable experience. I love that. And another Cuban cigar I smoked was the Ramon y Ramon Especially Selected. I have to say, those are just keep getting better. Every time I smoke, like the first
converted them, boys.
No, well, it's weird. Yeah,
we win.
I fool you guys totally. You guys totally win. I give up, white flag. When they first came in, I was kind of like, eh. Then I smoked another one, and I was like, yeah, okay. Then I smoked another one, and I was like, wow, that's pretty good. Now I'm smoking it, and I'm like, holy crap, blown away, blown away. And the Boulevard was a similar kind of experience.
Definitely on my short list of favorite Cubans that are out there.
We'll keep that in mind for our next segment, so just saying.
Okay.
Okay. Tim, back to you.
I got nothing left, man. That's it.
Oh, okay. So I'm on the NHC Surrogates, the Skullbreaker. I think say it. I think you're compelled to say it.
Skullbreaker, not Skullcrusher.
Skullbreaker. Skullbreaker.
Sounds like Hulk Hogan.
Yeah. It's the Skullbreaker. Mm-hmm. It was 5 1/4 by 52 Bellicoso, coming in at 750, exclusively available at New Havana Cigars. This was just way too much cigar. I mean, completely over the top, full flavor. And not a great flavor. I mean, it was okay. The flavor was overwhelmed by the strength. And it's weird. It's not like that Opus nicotine overwhelming. It's like a flavor and strength overwhelming. It's a different overwhelming than the Opus. It's weird. It's weird. So it's got a little like bitterness and harshness to it. I think the Opus is smooth, but just like overwhelms you with nicotine. This has nicotine, but the flavors seem to be a little bitter and harsh. It starts to mellow out a little bit. Maybe it'll be an awesome cigar in like 10 years of aging. Try one. Yeah. I said try one if you dare.
Yeah, and to get back to your assessment or question about that small 45-minute smoke, is that little petite by Milano, the V?
Number four.
Mm.
Oh, man, that thing was awesome.
Oh,
so this
oh
is, man. God, it was awesome.
Was your lips, like, tingling in the beginning?
Yeah, and
not with the nuts.
So this is a box press Oliva V called the Milano?
Oh, yeah, it's a little number four. That thing is the strongest of all three.
Those are really
good.
I actually alluded to that earlier. That was like that one and the Quesada were the two that I really, really wanted to get my hands on the most.
The local shop sold out by the time I got there.
I know it, huh?
I got there the next day. Yeah.
Maybe you knew someone to get some.
Bunch of jerks. It's
like I did part of that. Like,
No.
If you develop a relationship with a local shop like we've recommended on the show, that you'd be able to walk in and at least get one of something new that everyone's raving about. Instead, you get none, and you get to hear how great it was. Yeah. Does that suck or what?
Oh, I put it down and someone bought the box.
Wait, you guys wouldn't know how much that sucked. No, I have that size.
He's got the other one too.
I get the sizes.
I got all of them.
But that number four,
you got
back to you.
He set out the text immediately. I sent it back two of each.
And then it came in. The guy bought the whole box. But we that's all we can get. They're coming in though.
Okay.
Mm. They are. That, but my lips. Oh man, that was something, huh?
So I've got a Cuenca Blanco Robusto Deluxe. Now I've tried the Lonsdale Club. I've tried the Corona, and I have to be honest with you, I don't get why people rave about these sizes. And everyone seems to allude to the draw being a little snug on the Lonsdale Club. To me, that kind of takes away from the smoking experience, and I didn't get it. I smoked two of these Robustos, and I tell you,
that's the weakest of the.
I think it's the strongest so far. I really do.
I enjoyed the Lonsdale. Well, everyone's going to say the Lonsdale is the best, and whatever, because Jose himself said it was his favorite.
But is it just everyone going along with what he's saying though? Is it subliminal?
I love maybe I can't answer that, but I'll tell you what. See, on the flip side, I just really enjoy the Corona. The Robusto. I only smoked one of them, and it didn't really deliver for me. And no, I gotta go back.
This one, I gotta come back in and get the other sizes because I've smoked five of the Lonsdales. But
this, to me, I mean, full of flavor, medium bodied. I mean, it changed up. I mean, this was my smoke of the week. Absolutely, hands down.
You don't do well with the smaller ring gauges sometimes.
I don't have good luck with them a lot of times. Yeah, well, it's not all the time. I think when a lot of people like the smaller ring gauges, I tend to kind of buck the system there. There are some exceptions to that, such as some of the Paul Gamarians, the Reserva Exclusiva, for example, the Corona and the Panatella. I mean, and I've smoked almost every other size in the line, and those two sizes are hands down, without question, my favorite. All the time. It's just, I don't know.
We're in agreement on the 100 Años Lancero. I smoked one of those yesterday.
Yeah, those awesome. Are fantastic, too.
That's the bell of the ball.
So, I mean, it depends. This is a great cigar, though. The Cuenca y Blanco Robusto, I really like. Ecuadorian Habano wrapper and all kinds of different binder and filler. Piloto Cubano, some Nicaraguan Ometepe, Esteli, Peruvian in the filler. And I agree with the assessment. It's a strength. I say strength medium. I don't get the full on
Who
this
said
one.
It was full?
This was one of the reviews that I linked to here. It's definitely the review where I say nice review here. It definitely is the Stogie guys probably gave it the best review that I found. The body full and the flavor full. I agree with that. It's full body.
Flavors? Is this guy on Coke?
So then this other review that I linked to here.
Oh, that's a different one you sent me.
Casa Fumante. This is the one I sent around to the...
Yeah.
So this is the one I labeled as the completely ridiculous review.
Yeah.
Because they list 9 different flavors, and that's just in the first half. If you keep reading in that review, there's more, a whole list of other flavors they find in the second half. I tend to question reviews that are listing 9 different flavors in the first third of a cigar.
Was it a gym bag?
No, there was no gym bag.
Oh,
no.
Hockey bag.
There was vanilla, there was honey, there was spice, there was mint,
nutmeg,
there was cinnamon. I mean, you name it, it was there. So,
if he can taste it, good for him.
Is that review done by one person or is it done by a collective?
It's one person.
That's a little insane.
It's insane.
Like if there was 5 people on the panel.
The thing to me, if you're putting up reviews and you're getting 9 different flavors, I mean, you're kind of detracting from all of the media in general because everyone's going to start saying, well, I mean, they're just pulling stuff out of their ass. Don't go there. Don't do that. I don't like it when you have to list that many flavors. If you've got an advanced palate, all the more power to you. But focus on, for the rest of us, like what we want to get out of the cigar. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's why I like the 5 of us here. We don't always agree. And that's what I like, as opposed to sitting there with 9 different flavors. Hey, whatever. Good for him. Whatever. That's all I got to say. I got to tell you, my friend, this thing has got a great little... What a finish.
I'm down to the last inch, and I'm burning my lips on it, man. Mm-hmm. I'm really enjoying the smoke right now.
You talk about a cigar that's probably maybe... close to medium in strength, but full flavor.
I've got, I'm really enjoying the cigar. So we talked about that one. I smoked another Fuente Opus X Magnum.
I never had that one. How was that?
Yeah, this is the 56 ring gauge. It's like 5.5 by 56. It's a large ring gauge Opus X. Has to be one of my top 3 Opus sizes. It's interesting how the ring gauge allows the strength to kind of mellow out, but still delivers in the flavor department. This is the... To me, my recommendation, the non-Opus X smoker's Opus.
Because of the size.
That larger ring gauge, I really think if you're not a big fan of Opus, try it in the larger ring gauge. It's just a straight large ring gauge, right? It's not a BBMF where it does get to 60 ring at its largest point. This is a straight 56 all the way through. And I tell you, they burn great. They taste great. It's not overpowering in strength. It kind of... evens out the blend just enough. And I think it's all those different sizes of Opus are what really makes it kind of a fun blend to try.
Yeah,
because every size is so different, and this one is no exception.
That dude's got some nasty fingernails. I ain't you.
I know, huh? Yeah, God. That's my fingernails.
Who is that guy?
I gotta...
Man, what
you
is
know,
that?
You know, up on the big screen, you can really see how horrible.
That's not even high. That's not even high def either. Whew.
Yeah, that's
okay,
pretty bad.
Move on.
Okay. Liga Privada Unico Series L40. These were re-released and came back into the store. You can read our full review. Episode 6, we featured this cigar.
Yes.
And I really love them. Now, this stick was just awesome. It has this dark, fruity flavor that I just love. I mean, I buy them whenever they come out because I love that I can really identify with that flavor profile, and I come back to it, and it's right there. Poor smoke. Nice burn. It needs to develop a little bit with age. Mm-hmm. I'd say I smoked it out. It was in my humidor for a couple days, maybe, and then I smoked it. It needs to settle out a little bit. Tim said that he loves everything Liga Privada and gave this a box-worthy rating. I wholeheartedly agree. This is a box-worthy smoke. Even though, Tim, you didn't pick one up in the last round, which I was kind of surprised at.
Yeah, well, is like that I just said, I broke the budget.
Broke the budget.
Yeah.
I got to ask you, Tim, and everybody, the Ratzilla. I want to hear comments on Ratzilla.
I still haven't smoked mine.
No, neither have I because of all the comments I heard about it in the beginning.
Everybody told me to wait, and that's what I did. They're still sitting. Mm-hmm.
So now you listen.
Well, yeah.
I come from a different site, that's why. Don't listen to those stogie guys.
Oh, boy. Okay. So I think that was it up on my list. Oh, no, the Mini Bellicoso I had up there. And I talked about this one already. I put the... I still, La Dueña, my favorite new release so far, without question. Mm. As far as
it's
being
definitely up there, but
as far as being likable, all the sizes
it's
being
in
really
the top
good.
Five. I mean, I can see someone saying they like it, the favorite. I can see they like it. You know, it's definitely. I mean, my opinion, it was my third favorite out of the show.
Mm.
It really was.
So what was your favorite coming out of IPCPR? Let's go around. Stogie Santa.
God, it's a toss up. I have to go. I tell you, what was the the one for Four Kicks. Headley Grange.
Haven't smoked that one yet.
That I was really a complex cigar. Really different flavors.
Now, do you have those in the shop yet? Or
no.
Okay.
Well, that was a lie. I've got this lie detector hooked up to the mixer. It was off the charts.
No, they're not in the shop.
You ever see the movie Sneakers where they dial the NSA and he's got the lie detector?
No, I would never.
Detector.
I would never.
He's like, he's lying.
I would never do that.
Dan Aykroyd just whispered in my ear when you said that. He goes, he's lying. He's lying.
It's not a lie.
It's just not the whole truth. Mark Jr., favorite cigars to come on IPCPR?
Without thinking.
So far.
Without
thinking, because that would ruin the show completely.
The Jalapa.
That would just throw us off the base.
Okay.
How about you,
but
Tim?
I haven't had the Headley Grange yet, so.
Yeah. I haven't had the Jalapa.
So far, I'm going to say it's La Dueña, but it's too early to tell, man. There's so much I haven't smoked yet, you know?
It's true.
Yep.
All right. Well, we're going to take a short break here on the Stogie Geek Show and come back with the next segment on some rants and raves and Cuban cigars.